think that nothing could ruin summer. Running around barefoot through the tangled brush, fishing with my friends, and getting into things that was none of my business was all I would do in the hot months. The first summer that was ever ruined for me was the summer I turned 14. After a rough game of tackle football in the hard, rock-filled backyard that left us bruised, four of the five boys I was playing with left to go home to get some lunch, which only left me and Jake. He was a skinny boy that wasn't afraid of anything, or at least that's what he said. I, on the other hand, carried more weight. It was just the Ravens. I sat down under a cedar and was staring out across the 9-acre field that was behind my folks' trailer at the time. Off in a clearing was another trailer, whose bed was ours from the outside. We used to visit the man that lived there when we got the chance. His name was Jess, and he would always give me and Jake an apple and a Pepsi when we stopped by and told us some of the craziest stories we'd ever heard. Jake looked over and said we ought to go up there because we hadn't been there in so long, and no one else had heard from him in a few days. We took off out across the tall weeds, briar patches, thistles, and tangled thorns to go see the old man. It was a good day for walking. The sky was dry and blue with wisps of white clouds, and the breeze that was blowing around the smell of honeysuckle and magnolia. Slapping shivers and scratching diggers said we recounted some of the last story he told us. It's about him and his buddy getting caught with about 100 catfish in the bed of their truck. When the cop asked if they'd been drinking, Jess said, "No, sir, we've been fishing." That was my favorite story of them all. Entering his yard, we heard his dog howling on the fence behind his trailer. The dog, Mongo was his name, was a Rottweiler that was massive even by the terms of his breed. He was pacing back and forth and throwing his head up to the blue sky, turning loose howls like I had only heard once before. I heard that howl when Jake's mother passed. We were outside in his tent and heard the howl of his dog, and by morning they were loading her body up. He gave me chills that shook me down my bare, bloody feet just thinking about it. We banged on the thin aluminum door and looked through the glass rectangle and saw he was lying on next to the wall under his window. "We've got to go in there and see if he's all right," I said, sweating heavily and trying to catch my breath. "No, we don't. We can't. Listen to me. We're just going to go over, play in that creek, and act like we ain't seen nothing," Jake says, pulling down and looking up at me. "We've got to go in there. If they hadn't thought of him by now, they ain't thought of him yet for a while. If you leave now, I swear to God, I'll tell everyone I scared you," was our reply. Before looking in the little window again. I tried to twist the knob, but it was locked and burning hot from the summer sun. Jake reluctantly went around the back door, which was likewise locked. "We don't know. Why don't we just go get someone?" Jake said. "We don't know if he's hurt or anything. He could just be asleep." "Look, I'm going," he started to say as he was going down the middle stairs. He couldn't finish because I grabbed his arm and pulled him backwards hard and fell against the door, busting it open. We were suddenly lying on the dirty carpet of Jess's trailer. I got to my feet by pushing up on Jake, to which he complained. I turned around and something felt wrong. I was wondering what it was, looking around, afraid to walk forward. Then I figured it out. Vicious heat was pouring out of the trailer along with the smell I never forgot. Rotten meat and fruit would have been pleasant compared to the smell. Every part of my body wanted to run away, but I slowly started walking towards Jess. Jess said something I didn't hear clearly. After he said whatever he said, I heard him take off out the door and crash through the underbrush. I was standing over him. I took my foot and rolled him towards me, and he came to rest on his back. The smell became intense, and what I saw made me vomit on the floor next to him. His stomach was busted open, and the contents were splattered on the drywall. The wall was a soft yellow at the point of impact, but black rock grew up the wall from there. The gore didn't bother me as much as it should have. It was his eyes. His once blue eyes were glazed over and milky. He died with his eyes open. I'm not sure how long I stood over him, but I couldn't leave. Sickness was coming to me in waves that seldom passed but often arrived. I heard dogs siren and people rushing through the vines and